guys, and welcome to my channel. Today's story is taking place in California, a state I'm sure most of you know worldwide, but I'll tell you a little bit about it just in case. It's known for its beautiful Pacific Coast beaches, its national parks, and its tourist attractions, and of course, as you know, there's just a whole hubbub of life there. Now, in the heart of Orange County, there was a crime that took place in November of 1991, and even though California has seen its share of terrible crimes over the years, this one still shocked not only the state of California, everybody in the city it took place in, but the entire nation. Let's get right into the story. All right, everyone. So as I stated earlier, this takes place in California, specifically in Costa Mesa, California, which is known as the heart of Orange County, and is also known as one of California's most eclectic and artistic cities. It seems to have a lot of good things. This is why this crime shook everyone so bad. Let's first talk about our victim. So, the victim of this heinous crime is named Bill Nelson. Now, I don't have a lot on his upbringing or anything, but I do have a pretty good background on what he was like as a person shortly before his death. So, as I said before, he's living in Costa Mesa. He was described as having a big personality. He is 56 years old at the time of this crime in November 1991. He has 5 children. He is described as charismatic, fun. People really just like to be around him. And he drives around a little red Corvette. Now, he has 5 children at this time. He was at one time a pilot, but then it was the 80s and he was caught going from Colombia back into Texas and caught with a whole plane load of marijuana. So that landed him in federal prison for roughly 4 years. The next key player in this story is going to be the murderer. Her name is Omaima Nelson. She was initially born in southern Egypt in a poor farming village with next to nothing. It is described that her family was living with abuse from her father. So her mother eventually divorced him and left for Cairo, where they lived in a slum known as the City of the Dead. And the reason why this was called the City of the Dead is because it was built around graveyards and tombs and, you know, just places where people shouldn't be living. But that was the slum that she grew up with. So she just went from rural poor to, you know, urban poor. And it did not sound like she had a good life at all. She, you know, had female mutilation done to her. Terrible, terrible things. She was abused and she wanted out. When she was 18, she met an American oil worker. Now, at this time, she was an absolute ravishing beauty and she knew it. You know, she at this point had been growing up with the abuse. She knew what it was like to go without, and she also adapted to her surroundings. So she used her beauty to her advantage, which, go girl. She was 18. She met an American oil worker and had a whirlwind romance. You know, she had him wrapped around her little finger. And growing up, you know, in a Muslim household, which it said she was, her family pushed for her to marry this oil worker. And she was all on board with it and agreed to do so. So I cannot find the name of this oil worker who she initially married, but she married him and moved to America, which was her ultimate goal in a lot of ways, it is said. But after only roughly a year of marriage, her husband left her and left her lonely in Texas. Now, Omaima is at some disadvantage here because she is not a native English speaker, nor does she speak English well at this point, but she understands the power of her beauty. She is this beautiful woman, built beautifully, beautiful skin, beautiful features. She's just a striking individual. And just like in Egypt, she knows how to use this to her advantage. So it is said she would meet men in bars and, you know, have a very short fling with them, short passionate flings, and migrated with this and eventually found herself in Costa Mesa, California. Now, as any of you fellow Americans know, California is not a cheap place to live, especially Orange County. So without any real work skills, she found herself having to clean houses. She was an occasional nanny. And as I said, she had stunning looks. So she ended up being a model every once in a while. So that was nice. She, of course, did not like having to do this hustle. So she went back to her old pattern of going to the bars and meeting men, specifically older men. Now, this will come up later, of course, as you probably have already seen with my introduction of Bill Nelson, but this is a bit of an MO of her. So just so you guys are aware, in October of 1991, Omaima found Bill Nelson, who I already told you he's gonna get it. He was at the beginning, so she found him in a bar. He was very taken aback by her. They had an instant click, people would say, and it was another whirlwind romance for Omaima. They seemed very happy, and within 3 weeks, they were driving to Phoenix to get married. At this point, Bill took Omaima to go see his family in Texas and Arkansas. Now, as I said earlier, Bill had 5 kids, and they were none too keen on Omaima because she's 23 at this point, and he's 56. A lot of his children are older than their new stepmom. Like, that's a bit rough. So they were very apprehensive and suspicious of this whole thing because, I mean, it's screaming gold digger, right? Like, how is it? That's 100% what was going on. It is said, though, there was like a bit of a story that went with the whole thing. Bill Nelson's stepdaughter eventually comes to like her because they were at horseback riding and Omaima got kicked off the horse. Now, she got bucked off pretty good. And it was intense. And they were like, oh, God, do you need to go to the hospital? Like, what do we need to do for you? And she was like, nah, give me aspirin and vodka. And she took it and got back on the horse. And they were like, oh, my God, this bitch is tough. Oh, my God. So the stepdaughter said she had a new gained respect for her because she, I mean, flying off a horse like that, people have got paralyzed, killed by that. That's some intense shit getting bucked off like that. So Omaima was tough, to say the least, in case you didn't notice before, since she's already adapting to her environment, like, nobody's business. The last time Bill Nelson spoke to any of his family members was Thanksgiving, and it was his stepdaughter again, and she was saying he sounded really happy. They were in his Orange County apartment because he was living in an apartment this time with Omaima, and they were having a turkey dinner with quote-unquote all the fixings, and he sounded super, super happy. It, you know, this was still sounding super nice. Her family's feeling really good about it at this point, but 3 days later, it would be a very, very different story. So as I said, 3 days later, bear with me, this is going to get chaotic. Jose Esquivel, who I have not mentioned before, becomes a key player in this case. So he had heard all this noise about 6 a.m. Like, he just hears pounding on the door and a woman's voice saying, open up, open up, open up. And there's a red Corvette out front and he doesn't know who the hell it is. So he refuses to answer and goes back to bed. About 3 hours later, the same thing happens. This time he goes and looks to the door and he knows who's at the door. It is a girl he dated for a brief period of time. And guess who it is? It's Omaima. Oh my God. So shocking. Now she rushes in. She's all distraught. He's like, what the hell is going on? And he finally gets her to like calm down enough to talk, right? And she told him, I had to kill my husband. I killed my husband, but it was self-defense. And she goes on to tell him that she had escaped Bill after he had raped her. And so she said she killed him, but now she needs help getting rid of the body because she doesn't know what to do. So she's gone to Jose for this. And he's like, oh, okay. Playing along, right? So he goes, okay, Omaima, stay here. I need to go get my truck so we can properly move this body. And she's like, okay, yeah, I'll do that. Jose steps out, goes to the police station, tells him everything going on. So good for Jose, dude. I'm glad. That's, if you're going to be a snitch, that's the time to do it, right? Like, that's just being a good person. That's not even snitchy behavior. That's just what you're supposed to do. So after he tells the cops show up at Jose's house where Omaima was at the time. She freaks out and then starts backtracking on her story and goes, oh, what? Like, Jose did not understand what I said it up. My husband's alive. He's he's just in Florida. I just need help with my house. And the cops are like, what the hell? So that red Corvette I had mentioned before is sitting out front. They run the plates on it and see that it is tied to Bill. They search the car and they find a trash bag. And in the trash bag, trigger warning, turn off now if you don't like to do graphic stuff, human organs wrapped up in newspaper. So at this point they're like, Omaima, what the actual shit? Like, why is this in your car? Like, you got explaining to do here, miss? Excuse you? And she's like, what? Oh, that was Bill. He's up to some nasty shit. And they're like, yeah, okay. So they convince her to go to the police station. Now, she will not sit down to save her life, right? She just keeps pacing and pacing back in the interrogation room. And then she's saying all this crazy stuff. And I'm sorry I don't have an interrogation video. Like, finding footage for this story was hell. But anyways, she's pacing and pacing back and forth and just is mumbling some crazy bullshit, right? And every once in a while, she'll talk about a hallucination she's having. She's looking like a crazy person, right? Like somebody having some severe mental issues. And so the cops finally get her to settle down enough. They're like, you know what? Like, we know you're going through a really hard time. Let's take you to the hospital just because, you know, we need to take that rape kit because you were raped and we don't want, you know, we want to make sure you're protected. So they convince her to go down to the hospital. Meanwhile, while that's going on, they go to Bill Nelson's apartment after they get a search warrant and bust in. And what they find is horrific. Now, it needs to be said, their house was cluttery because Bill would rebuild computers. So there was some clutter and stuff. But the more they looked, the more creepy stuff was going on. There was all sorts of, just like that first trash bag, there was body parts in bags. There, his head was found in the freezer and they couldn't just identify it because it had been deep fried and it was sitting in there with the Thanksgiving leftover. That is nauseating. I am so sorry. Who the heck? So fucking gross. Anyways, so there's that. They see his hands severed and it's just gruesome. There's blood on the mattress. Now they take, at that time, Omaima had said that he had bound her up to rape her and they had seen the headboard. Like, it was clear somebody was tied up and it snaps. So they're like, oh, okay, maybe that did happen. Maybe this is going down. They also found the lamp that she claimed to hit him with. They're like, okay, maybe this is more true than we realized. But they took a look at his hands again. Omaima was not the one bound up, but Bill was, because the bruising on his wrists lined up with being bound up. So at this point, we go back to the hospital where Omaima is at this moment. Her rape kit came back negative. So they're like, okay, you know, there was no sign of it. And not only that, the lacerations we're seeing from her are those tied to someone who would have dismembered a person. That's what the lacerations are showing. The evidence they took shows signs of self-defense and dealing with another body. So at this point, we're pretty damn sure Omaima has not been telling the truth, right? Like, nothing is lining up. Okay, so after the cops had more time to investigate this crime scene at Bill's apartment, you know, because they couldn't get a positive ID initially, they were able to confirm it was Bill Nelson. They were able to confirm he was hit with a lamp to the head, like she had said. The scary part that the investigators and the autopsy report was showing is that Bill was cut up with such precision, they were worried if this was Omaima's first hit. Because they said people who usually, like, this wasn't looking like a crime of passion. This was looking quite calculated, and she was damn good at what she did. There were precise cuts, she was efficient, and it was messy. Now, another disturbing thing about the findings of this is they compared Bill Nelson's stats on his driver's license, as far as his weight goes, to what they weighed. And there was about 80 to 100 pounds of him unaccounted for, which at this point, the investigators are going, this got some Dahmer vibes. Like, she's sounding like a kid. You don't just lose 80 pounds of a person. Like, what the shit is going on? So, with these two main things being the professional chop shop going on, and the percentage of Nelson missing, they start to look into Omaima's background, and they find some interesting stuff. Now, they did notice she had that dating pattern that I had brought up before, right? Like, she would use her beauty, go find men. She really liked older men, and she had a lot of theft, petty theft, shoplifting on her record. And actually, one time she was arrested because there was female security guards that went after her for shoplifting, and she snapped on them. And the one female security guard, she almost bit her breast off, and then the other one she grabbed by the crotch and severely injured her as well. So Omaima is violent and has violent crimes. And another person who had not spoken up before until this point, Robert Hansen, comes into play. Now, Omaima had lived with him briefly. Their relationship had a very similar MO to Bob and him. So she briefly lived with him. Now, he said he also got tied up by her. She acted like it was going to be like a sexy role play thing, right? And held him at gunpoint. Now, lucky for him, she didn't do the bindings right. So he was able to get out of there, knock the hand out of her, and get her the hell out. But he was too embarrassed to come forward. So he never filed a police report against it. And he said he didn't do that because he was so embarrassed. All right. So at this point, we are moving on to the court hearing. So the prosecution was going for the fact that Bill was tortured to death. That is what they claimed. They said that he refused to agree to Omaima's terms, so ultimately he was tortured. Robert Hansen, the person that she had tied up before and had escaped her, testified against her during this time. And, you know, she had talked about all these times. She said once that Bill tried to hurt her, like he said he was going to kill her and bury her in the desert on their way to Phoenix. But they played footage of that family trip that I had mentioned before, and they looked so happy and so in love. Nobody was buying that bullshit. No one. So the prosecution leaned on the fact that her contradiction and her MO was pointing to her being more of a manipulator and much less of a victim than what she had claimed. Now, the defense's side was that her abuse was her motive, that she finally snapped. She just couldn't take her abuse anymore. They told everybody about the female circumcision, which is what she had had before, which is a terrible, terrible procedure that still happens sometimes in countries that is just atrocious for women's rights and just a terrible thing to do to another person. You know, brought up the PTSD from the childhood abuse she had faced. Then she claimed that the whole family, her whole family that she grew up with, was somehow abusive to her, whether it was emotional, physical, or even sexual. So she was just beaten her whole life. So, you know, once again, this is what the defense is going after. They claim Bill Nelson assaulted her daily. This is the claim. And she also leaned into that whole insanity thing. She at one point said she had taken Bill's ribs, boiled them all nice, and ate them. And she said because she was from the land of the dead in Cairo, that the ancient belief around Osiris, and if you don't know that myth, he was chopped up and pushed all around by his brother Seth and then re-put back together and brought back to life. And she said because of the Osiris myth, it was part of the customs that the demons in her head told her to do. So she's really leading in on this insanity thing. They also had a psychological evaluation done on her, and the psychologist said that she was very childlike and seemed detached from reality and also delusional. And the psychiatrist said that, you know, Omaima truly believed that these ancient Egyptians, these old spirits. She said, you know, it was demons and old spirits were acting through her. So, yeah. Now, if you watch the Snapped series, there was one juror that I think kind of fell in love with Omaima and they just happened to show him, allegedly, but still, they were trying to get her on first degree murder. But ultimately, the sentence came down to she was found guilty of second-degree murder. And she was also found guilty of assault with a deadly weapon for her act against Robert Hansen. Her reaction was she apologized but claimed she was fighting for her life. Now, a funny thing that it's not funny, but it's kind of funny. In prison, it is noted that she somehow found an older man, like, bound up in a wheelchair, super wealthy, of course, and he would come and have conjugal visits with her. And when he passed, she just got all sorts of money. So yeah, she's still grifted from jail. And let's see here. So that case ended in 1993, right? So here's a little bit of the aftermath. She became eligible for parole in 2006, but she was denied because, quote unquote, commissioners found her unpredictable and a serious threat to public safety because of her past records. I totally agree with that. She became eligible again in 2011, but was denied again, saying that she hadn't taken responsibility for the murder and she wouldn't be a productive citizen if she was freed. She will be able to seek parole again in 2026. So there you have it. That is the case of the potential cannibal Omaima Nelson and her poor victim, Bill Nelson. You know, not everything is black and white in this case. However, I feel like her abuse, this is my view of everything. Her abuse made her have sociopathic tendencies. So I don't think she was being abused by Bill Nelson, but I think she was probably so abused growing up. She became detached from empathy and learned how to survive through manipulation. That is what everything is pointing to for me. And, you know, I have some empathy, of course, for her being so traumatized as a child, but that doesn't mean that you can go and kill people if they don't give you their money. So, I mean, I feel bad she was hurt as a child and think she should still be in prison. Like, that was fucked up and wrong. And I don't think Bill deserved that. I mean, they were both being he was probably being a little shallow though, right? Like, he was in my opinion, chasing around a sexy 23-year-old piece of ass. That's what he was doing. So, I mean, he ain't no angel, but he didn't deserve what happened to him, and she didn't have the right to do what she did. So that's my opinion. Tell me below what you guys think. If you disagree with me, if you have anything to add, let me know. And thank you so much for giving me a little bit of time to your day, and have a great one.